Welcome to all. My name's Bill Sutherland. The Humanitas Chair in Sustainable Science is just terrific. For the third year running, we've managed to bring along a global leader to come and talk to us, and with the objective, I think, of destroying them by a series of exhaustive meetings and forcing multiple dinners down them. Some might view this as a way of us trying to take out the competition, and I assure you it's not. It's meant as a collaborative, positive exercise. We'd like to thank the Vidal Hoffman Trust and the Teller Mellor Foundation for generous funding that made all of this possible. This has been organised by a number of people. It's been organised by the Centre for Research in the Arts, Social Science and Humanities, or CRASH as you all know it. It's got the best acronym, I think, along with the Cambridge Conservation Initiative, CCI, and the University of Cambridge Conservation Research Institute, CCRI. Not quite so good acronyms, I think. I think we need to rethink and have something like CRASH. I think that sounds great. Paul burst onto the scene with his work demanding to know whether or not interventions worked and assessing the effectiveness of a whole series of large-scale interventions. They're hugely influential papers that have made people think about whether or not we should carry out certain interventions and the way in which we should do science, the way in which we can actually rigorously assess the effectiveness of interventions and the importance of doing so. This has influenced all sorts of people and it's had real traction with policymakers. So I think we can move out of the current wilderness into a promised land of milk and honey, where we have people looking at interventions, assessing what works, and then carrying out interventions on the basis of evidence and what actually is effective. We need a leader in that, and we have a leader, Paul Ferraro, our new Moses. Paul, welcome.
Thank you for that introduction. That's going to be hard to match. I appreciate that. My mother sent you that, I think. Thank you for that. I don't think we have a crowd the size of last night. That's fantastic. Usually when I give my first lecture in classes, I get maybe 30 people show up for the class, and by the second class, it's down to about 15. So this is fantastic. I see a lot of the same faces that you came a second time in a row. I'll try to deliver. I have been worn down a bit by all the meetings and talking, but if you know me, you know I like to talk, so it's not that difficult of a situation to do. But I'm going to try to do some more interaction today. I want this to be, it's a big group, but to be more of a discussion. Right? So the question is up here is, what do we know about impacts, moderators, and mechanisms? I can tell you right off the front, related to protected areas, we know more than a lot of other conservation interventions, but we don't know much. And so I want a lot of this to be a discussion, and also a discussion about what's good evidence, right? So I'm going to put forward how I view what the literature says so far, try to clarify what I mean by these terms, impacts, moderators, and mechanisms. There's a lot of confusion. People use these terms or analogous terms. But just to give it a sense, so Bob Preston had this edited issue in Philosophical Transactions B. Came out in the fall, it has this grandiose title, Measuring the Differences Made by Protected Areas. And it was supposed to be about, you know, the frontier and all the things that we're doing. And I wrote an introductory article with Bob just saying, you know, this is the things that should be done in this field. And then we've got the articles. And some of you actually, maybe in this room, have co-authors on this. But I got an email from a smart aleck colleague in Europe, who I'll remain unnamed, who said, you know, I read your introduction about all the things that, you know, what we should be doing, and I read the articles in the issue, and it didn't seem like they were related at all. And part of that's the problem of doing an edited issue is trying to get everybody, doesn't do necessarily what you want to do, but it's also because the stuff is hard, and we've got a ways to go in the environmental community to do good impact evaluations that we can draw inferences from that can guide management and program design in the field. And it's more important than just program design. So there's a nice essay in this special issue by Dan Brockington and David Wilkie on protected areas and poverty. It's a pretty short essay. It's worth reading. But the one thing they point out in there is that this debate continues to rage because our evidence is so lousy about the impacts of protected areas and poverty, that narratives and anecdotes rule, and everybody's got their own narrative and anecdote, and we never get anywhere in this debate. It's the same debate. I mean, since Bill Adams had his article about poverty and conservation. It's the same debate that continues to rage. So this lack of evidence is not just important for program design and having impacts in the government. It's also so we can stop spending our time on these debates that rage on endlessly without any resolution. All right, so the first thing I want to focus on is just this idea of effectiveness and impacts. So if you did this with me last night, you already know what I'm doing, you might still be in the session. But what I want you to do is, this is always a risk, technology, taking out your cell phones, I don't want to hear them ringing later if we can do that. Oh, people are already doing it. So there's a London phone number up there, 020-3322-5822. I'd like you to take out your phone and text. It's not going to cost you anything, you're not going to get spam, this is polleverywhere.com. It's easy to leave the session, but it's allowed me to do some audience interaction. I want you to text my name, Paul Ferraro 680. Like I said last night, I'm not a narcissist. I want you to type my name out so you can more easily remember it in the future. It's just that's what they gave me for the program. Just text Paul Ferraro 680, doesn't have to be capital letters, to 020-3322-5822. I didn't do that. I know you all have cell phones. And then I want you to choose, there's no right answer in any of the things that I'm going to be doing today to these questions. I want you to consider two 10,000 kilometer squared protected areas in rainforest in Indonesia. They're equivalent in all respects in terms of the community characteristics, ecological functions, species, everything. Both protected. One, the scenario, the thought experiment is since establishment, 50% of the protected area is degraded compared to 90% degraded had the area not been protected. So in this parallel world, had we not protected that area, 90% would have been degraded. And the other one is 10% of the protected area is degraded. When we look at it, had it not been protected, 11% would have been degraded. Which one would you consider more effective or successful or perform better? Again, there's no right answer. Just let's see what people have. And again, just for when you sign on to the text, you'll get a message that you've joined the session, and you can just leave the session by typing in LEAVE and texting it back to the number. But don't do that until the presentation's over. Again, okay. So most people say A. But when you look at the literature and when we talk about success and effectiveness, we largely focus on the scenario B, where we look at protected areas and see which ones are most degraded or not degraded. If they're not very degraded, success, they're doing well. If they're very degraded, we're failing. And that's true in one sense of success, that there are these performance metrics. We want to stop extinction. We want to turn the populations of elephants and gorillas around. We want to stop deforestation. We want to stop rhino poaching. And if the stuff is continuing, that's bad. And so there's nothing wrong with that, having those metrics. But there's also the issue of how are we affecting those metrics, those indicators? And what would it have been like had we not done protected areas, or had not done incentives or community participation or all the other things that we're doing? That's also important. All right, so here's an article in Nature, Bill Lawrence and a bunch of other people, some of you in this room might have been on this article, that had a whole set of indicators for protected areas, reserves all around the world. And their punchline was that there was great variation in reserve health, as revealed by these biological indicators. And they said that half of the reserves had stable or a small number had improving, mostly stable. And they said those were performing passably. And the rest were not. They were performing poorly. They were not effective. And so consider this thought experiment. What if I told you, I don't know this, but what if I told you that the half of the reserve with stable indicators, half of the reserve with stable indicators would have had improved values in the absence of the reserves, and the reserves with declining values would have had even worse values in the absence of the reserves? And which ones would be performing passably in that context? Most people would say, number two. Yeah, they were declining, but it would have been much worse, whereas in number one, we actually are doing worse, that those things would have actually improved, but because we did protection, we kept them stable through maybe conflict that we generate with local communities, I mean, there's a bunch of truly plausible mechanisms. So I'm not saying that's happened, but it's getting your idea around or your head around what we mean by impact or effective. There's two definitions. There are these benchmarks, these targets that we have that we want to achieve, and have we achieved them or not is important, but it's also important is what we're doing moving us in that direction compared to what it would be in an alternative world where we did something different with our conservation resources. And that second one is the one I want to talk about tonight when I talk about impact. I want to talk about impact. Let's take protected areas and let's take the outcome of deforestation. Doesn't matter. It could be poverty, it could be species diversity, it could be anything. All right, so we've got, typically we can see what's going on before we do protection, but in a lot of cases, like ecosystem services and species, we often don't even have the baselines. But we can observe that in box A. After protection, we can observe deforestation. All right? But when we talk about impact, impact is the difference between what we see happening in the protected area and what would have happened had the protected areas not been established. That's what we call the counterfactual. And the problem in impact evaluation is that box D is not observable. We can't see the protected area both with and without protection. And that's the problem for impact evaluation, is how do we get an estimate of this? Because if we don't have an estimate of this, so that we can take the difference between C and D on average across a different protected area types or in locations, we won't know what the impact is. So implicitly, sometimes what we do is we stick in A for D, and we say whatever it was before, that's what it would be like now. So we do these before-after analyses. Other analyses we do is we say, okay, let's take things that are not protected and pretend that's what protected areas would have looked like had they not been protected. So we compare protected areas to unprotected areas, or maybe in a buffer around unprotected areas. Right? But again, you're making a statement about these counterfactual outcomes, even if you don't do so explicitly. Right? And so when we're talking about impact evaluation, we're just talking about causal inference, which is done in lots of scientific enterprise. What causes cancer? Does this medical treatment make you better off or make you worse off? Do these training programs for poor women make them better off or make them worse off? We're talking about causality here, and it's all about collecting data to estimate counterfactual outcomes. I think I said yesterday during the discussion, we spend way too much time collecting data on indicators, on trends and status of the biosphere that we can't draw any inferences about counterfactual outcomes with. I don't want to collect more data. I want to collect data that helps us draw inferences about what would outcomes have looked like in the absence of a protected area or a different form of protected area or different conservation intervention. And that's another important point. We talk about the impact of protected areas. That's vague. It has to be in comparison to some other state. What is the counterfactual state? Is it compared to incentivizing local communities to protect their own resources compared to having multi-use local level reserves, or is it compared to having no conservation intervention at all in that area? You've got to specify. Each one of those counterfactual states can lead to a different impact estimate. So when someone's talking about impact, you have to ask compared to what? And sometimes in this presentation, I may not say that. If you want to press me on that, please do. But the most important thing to do to collect data on getting counterfactual outcomes is this step right here. Characterize the process by which some units, and that could be species, forest, parcels, administrative units, whatever the units are that you're studying, are exposed to the protected area and others are not. All right, so what I mean by this, and why this is important, is protected areas aren't randomly assigned across the landscape. Right, we're not running an experiment where I can just take the average condition in the protected area, the average condition in the unprotected area, take the difference, and that gives me a treatment effect. It's not a randomized controlled trial. The characteristics that are associated with where protected areas are put are also associated with ecological and social outcomes in the absence of the protected area. So here's a map from Thailand, and the takeaway message from here is that protected areas are placed on really steep land, the dark stuff. Really steep land is also used very differently by human beings than land that's not so steep. So if you're going to try to to figure out what's the impact of protected areas, and you want to compare it to unprotected areas, the very least you have to make sure you're comparing equal slopes. But there's a lot of other characteristics associated with protected areas. People have talked about high and far biases, but generally protected areas are placed where? In economically unprofitable areas, both in the marine environment and in the terrestrial environment, where there's politically powerless individuals who can't stop this regulation from landing on their front door. And those same characteristics also affect fishing behavior and terrestrial exploitation behavior. And so when you look at patterns out there, you're not sure, am I seeing the effects of protection, or am I seeing the effects of characteristics associated with where protection takes place? And these are called confounding variables. Right? And so any impact evaluation has to start with what is typically called in the jargon selection. Selection into treatment. Who's protected? Right? Nothing is more important than characterizing that process by which some units are exposed to protected areas or types of protected areas and other units are not. That's got to be the very beginning. And one of the key ways you can tell that the conservation community is lagged behind all other policy fields, which a lot of people have heard me say before, is that you never see that discussed in the beginning of articles. In every other field, that's the first thing they talk about. They talk about why are some people, units, communities, areas, states exposed to this program and others are not. Because that's going to give you insights into what kind of design you're going to be able to use to do impact evaluation. I've seen people come up to me and say, I'm going to do an analysis of protected areas or PS, I'm going to use matching. Well, why are you going to use matching designs? This is like a way to control for observable confounders. And well, I've seen that done. I want to control for things, but are you sure that these interventions are being assigned based on observable characteristics? Because if they're not, then you can't use that matching design to do your evaluation. So you don't do any thinking about what design to use, what kind of methods you're going to use until you talk about the selection. Because some of these factors are also going to affect the outcome. These are the confounders like slope, right? And you've got to address those. You've got to eliminate those rival explanations in your study. And some of these factors are only going to affect selection. They're only going to affect where protected areas are. These are called instrumental variables. I'm going to talk a little briefly about them. But we don't do enough of use of these sorts of things. And then once you understand the selection process, you choose a design. And this is one reason why global analyses might be nice. And they may get into high-impact journals, but they're unlikely to be very credible because the idea that selection is the same across all countries is hard to believe, and that you would have measures of the same things across all countries, hard to believe. I certainly think you might get better than previous analyses with some of these global things, but it's hard to believe that you're going to really understand the selection process at a global level. PAs, maybe. Other projects, not. All right, so I'm going to make three observations tonight. They're really simple. First one is impact evaluation is not straightforward. They're not randomly assigned for protected areas. You've got to eliminate rival explanations for the outcome patterns that you observe. And there's really only two ways we can do that with protected areas. We're not going to randomly assign them. So this is a picture that sort of deals with or portrays the problem we're faced with. So if D is the protection, right, that's what we're interested in. It affects some outcomes, poverty, deforestation, species diversity, ecosystem services, Y, through some mechanisms. And we want to measure the impact of D on Y. This is this causal relationship right here. And the problem is there's a whole bunch of factors that directly or indirectly associated with where protected areas are placed, the political power of the individuals, the economic profitability of the land or marine resources, that also connect to the outcomes we're interested in, fishing activity, deforestation, ecosystem services, poverty. All right, and then you have a whole bunch of factors that also affect deforestation and poverty that are unrelated to our protection. And then we've got some of these things here, C, that only affect protection but don't have any connection to Y except through their connection to protection. So there's really only two ways you can do impact evaluation of protected areas, right, when you're using observable data. You can either say, I'm going to figure out what these A, Bs, and Fs are, these confounding things, these things that are associated with where protected areas are placed or what kinds of protected areas are put there, and these outcomes. You need theory, previous studies, and field expertise to be able to do this. This is the selection process. And then I'm going to condition those out. I'm going to control for them, regression or matching analysis. Or you can say, I know a variable that only affects protection and will have an effect on my outcome, but only through its effect on protection, and I'll use that as a natural experiment. All right, I only know one study that's ever done that. It's a study by Kate Sims looking at the impacts of protected areas in Thailand on deforestation and poverty, where she makes the claim that protected areas are more likely to be placed when they're upstream from communities because the government wants to protect important watersheds. And she's claiming that whether you're far upstream from a community doesn't affect your deforestation because they're talking way downstream. You have a large city or something down there. I don't know if that's plausible or not, but that's the one example. The only other example I know is Jonah Bush has a paper on yellow-eyed penguins in New Zealand where he claims that conservation interventions happen close to roads because people doing it or don't want to go far from the roads because they want to get in and get out quickly, and that distance to road doesn't affect the penguin population because it's mainly oceanic conditions that are affecting the population. So you get sort of random variation in the conservation interventions as a result of distance to road, and he tries to use that to uncover the impacts. We could do more of this if we knew more about the process or by which protected areas take place, and again, that's going to be country or region specific. It's unlikely that globally we'll have a variable like this. But so there's only two ways to get at that. A deep understanding of what the confounders are and conditioning, so they're doing apples to apples comparison, or we find natural experiment where there's variation where protected areas get put or when they get put in that's unrelated to the outcomes. All right, so most of the studies that are out there, and people like Bill and others who have done some more systematic reviews can correct me if I'm wrong, have looked at impacts on deforestation and used conditioning strategies. These ideas, I'm trying to control for observable differences between unprotected and protected areas, between strictly protected and multiple use, if that's the contrast they're doing. All right, between protected areas that have participation and don't, indigenous reserves versus not indigenous reserves. And most have estimates on avoided deforestation that are generally less than 10%. All right, so 10% of the areas protected, roughly, would have been deforested had they not been protected. And that ranges anywhere from 0 to close to 20%. But roughly that around 10% is the numbers I've generally seen. The only one that differs is indigenous reserves. But as I was telling some people today, that those studies are likely to be highly confounded, that they're not distinguishing between what's the effect of just having indigenous people there versus having a formal reserve there. And there's a study coming out soon, or it's going to be submitted soon by not myself, somebody else who actually has data in the Amazon controlling for baseline presence of indigenous people. And when he does that, the effect of reserves, indigenous reserves, goes away. That really what those previous studies were doing was picking up just the presence of indigenous people, not the legal title to the land, which may have all these other social or environmental benefits, but not on deforestation. All right, so another question. There's no right answer to this one. I want to move on to mechanisms. I'm going to start with just one on the human welfare side. So in terms of average impact on human welfare in neighboring communities, protected areas, and say what you think, right? Are they having positive effects, very large or small ones? Are they having negative effects or little or no effect? So, I mean, one conclusion is big difference of opinion. I know consistency in that. And there isn't a right answer to this because we have so little good evaluation data, credible inferences about causal impacts of protected areas on human welfare. So it's not because you haven't read the literature, in my view, although some people who are doing systematic reviews on this may disagree. I think it's because there is not a lot of credible evidence on this. I'll talk about what I take away from the existing literature on this, But it's sort of interesting that you've got people on both sides of negative and positive. But most people think it's moderate either way. So the hard part about answering this is protected areas, again, are not randomly assigned. Where are they placed? They're placed next to poor people. So you go near protected areas, there are poor people there. And you can easily see they've been denied access to resources and a variety of other things. But the question is, how much of that poverty is being caused by protected areas and how much is being caused by the pre-existing conditions, both of the people and of the environment around them? So this is a picture of Costa Rica. This is poverty back in 1973, before or right at around the time when most of the protected areas were starting to be established. And the punchline here is that they were placed next to the most poor, the poorest people in the country. So right before protection even had a chance to have an effect on these communities, they were already among the poorest in the nation. So when you come back to 2016 and you look and you see that they're poor compared to everybody else, often that's been used as evidence that protected areas are immiserating people, where it's not clear, well, how much is this the pre-existing characteristics? These people would have been poor anyway, and how much of it is protected areas? So again, most of the approaches have been to try to do conditioning strategies. One of the big problems is we don't have baseline poverty for lots of countries like here, so people try to use indirect proxies to condition and then make the argument that what I'm comparing to the protected area communities are communities that are equally poor at baseline with equally equal expectations of changes in poverty in the absence of protection. But that's often untestable assumptions. Right? But it makes a difference if you don't think about the selection process again. So on the left, this is from an article in 2010, where if you just look at differences between communities that are not near protected areas and communities that are near protected areas, you see a big difference that makes it look like protection is exacerbating poverty, that the communities near protected areas are poorer on average, and this is an asset measure, as poverty index, than communities that are farther from protected areas. But if you only compare communities that are near protected areas to communities that are far, that were equally poor, equally on poor soil, steep slopes, far from markets, far from roads, so they had similar poor possible trajectories for economic development, you see the opposite pattern. You see a pattern where the communities near protected areas are actually wealthier than the communities that are far from protected areas, suggesting protected areas may be having a positive effect. It's pretty moderate, but you see the same pattern in Thailand. And when you look at the studies that have been done that do these conditioning strategies, you generally see that most studies are failing to detect poverty exacerbation. And of only one study that has, and then it's only in this heterogeneity analysis that we'll talk about problems with those sorts of things. But generally, a lot of the studies are detecting modest poverty reduction. It's about a fifth of a standard deviation. Right? But again, one of the problems is that you're still left with, have we controlled for all the relevant factors or not? Are these believable or not? And it really depends on having a strong understanding of selection. And it's not always clear that we do. I mean, a lot of times we're talking about protection that happened years ago, and nobody remembers exactly, or if you talk to people, the story that they give often doesn't match reality. If you ask people in Costa Rica, what areas did you protect? We protected the places that were about to go, that were about to go under the axe, the stuff that all the developers wanted. But then you look at the data, and you're like, this stuff is junky land. It's poor soil, steep slopes, far from roads and markets. What developers wanted this land? So again, getting at that selection story can be quite a challenge, but is absolutely critical to getting at impact evaluation. All right, so if protected areas are affecting social welfare, or if they're affecting ecosystem services or anything, big question is, what are the mechanisms? How does it work? Because if we understand the mechanisms better, we can design better protected areas. Right, let's just be clear on what a mechanism is. So a treatment is protection. This is the cause that we're interested in. The outcome is poverty, deforestation, ecosystem services, species diversity, whatever it is, the indicator that we're interested in seeing the impact of the protection on, and it works through some mechanism. It's on the causal pathway here. Moderators are things that moderate the impact of treatment on the mechanism or mechanism on the outcome. It might be something like slope. These are things that are not affected by protection, but affect how big of an impact protection has, not negative or positive. All right, so when people talk about, you know, where should we put protected areas under what conditions, that's talking about things that moderate it, but how does it actually work, talking about the mechanisms. And now we're worrying about confounding variables not only associated with treatment and outcomes, but also with the mechanism themselves. So this is getting harder if we want to get at mechanisms. And so before we look at what's been done in the literature and how people go about it, let's do another survey. Again, no right answer. And so if you were forced to pick one mechanism, protected areas likely to be most powerful in affecting human welfare, either positively or negatively, which service or which mechanism would you say? Change in tourism services, change in non-tourism ecosystem services, change in access to consumptive natural resources, change in infrastructure and development aid, changes in conflict. So these are things that protected areas are changing, which then subsequently affect human welfare. And I'm not specifying developed countries or developing countries. Interesting, a little more consensus. Well, it's going away now. I thought there were. We gotta wait for the older professors to get their thick fingers on the buttons. So small and change in tourism, and it seemed like change in access to consumptive natural resources and change in infrastructure services. Really interesting that ecosystem services is so low. So we're not in Stanford, I guess, right? We're giving this poll. The answer is we don't know, and I'll talk about why this is. All right, so first of all, we're lacking elaborate theories that even elaborate what are the mechanisms. So in that special issue, I wrote a review paper with Merlin Hanauer about mechanisms and protected areas. And the first thing we try to look through is the literature is what do people propose and how does it all fit together? And it was pretty weak. Like, people will pick one or two, but there's no elaborate models out there. So we give a simplified one here. But this is what we need. We need more elaborate theories. We can't even do empirical work until we have something people call these theories of change, causal models, that take protection to things that we care about, like species abundance. Right? We need to know, so here's the thing, protection affects roads development, NGO investment, and tourism, which then affects changes in economic returns to the land, human capital, migration, which affects how people perceive what they can get from exploiting the resources in the protected area, which then affects how they use the habitat and how they hunt, which changes the ecological conditions, which affects species abundance. And this could be elaborated for more, and it needs to be, right? Because without elaborate theories, there's no way we can have good empirical designs to tease this out. And in any study, you might decide, I'm not going to go all the way in here. I'm just going to look at how it changes hunting and habitat use. But it's all still the same stuff. I need now to not only worry about confounders that affect protection and species abundance jointly, but also things that affect NGO investment and roads that are also correlated with protection or correlated with species abundance. So it gets a lot harder to do. All right, so this is from a paper in 2014 where we try to get at three mechanisms associated with protected areas. Tourism services, change in tourism services, change in infrastructure, which roads, clinics, health clinics, and schools, and changes in land cover. And then we've got, this is everything else that we can't measure or haven't talked about. So you don't need to have a fully elaborated model, but you need to have some elaborated model. And you need to think about how everything is connected and what the confounding variables are so that you can eliminate those rival explanations so that you can try to figure out what is the different contributions of each of these mechanisms. Really hard to do for a variety of reasons. I should just say that fewer than half of a dozen published articles look at mechanisms that we could find, and most of them do what we call indirect analysis. They don't try to actually measure these mechanism effects. They instead say, look, if tourism is having an impact, then I should see an impact on wages closer to the tourism entrances than farther away from the tourism entrances. So what they do is they don't look at the protection's effect on tourism and then its effect on human welfare. They just look at protection's effect on wages and then say, do I see that impact larger near protected area, near the entrances, because that's where tourists are, than farther from the entrances. So it's sort of an indirect way. You basically posit, if this mechanism really operates, then I should see this. It's untestable. But then you posit that, if people believe that, then they go look to see if they see that pattern. And if they do, they say it's consistent with this particular mechanism. If they don't see it, they say it's inconsistent. But there's very few that actually try to go in and condition out confounding variables to measure the mechanism effects, because it's hard to do. And I thought I had a slide that talked about why, but I guess it's after this. So this is a paper that I did. And I don't want to stand by and say that I know that these are the right answers, because this is really hard stuff to do well. It's just an example. I want to show how it gets done. So it's from that previous slide where we try to disentangle the effect of protection on poverty index according to these three mechanisms, and then mechanisms that we couldn't postulate or didn't postulate, or dimensions of these mechanisms, tourism infrastructure and land cover, that we couldn't measure. So this one takes out health clinics and schools where there's no effect either, just to make the graph simpler to read. But basically, you're trying to figure out what's the effect of protection on tourism, infrastructure, and land cover. Those things change, and how does that change and affect poverty? And the bottom line from this analysis is that 2/3 of the poverty reduction we see is a result of changes in tourism activity as a result of establishing the protected area. Nothing's really coming from infrastructure, because the PAs didn't affect health clinics, roads, or schools. Again, we're not looking at quality, we're looking at quantity. So it could be on a quality dimension, down in this dotted line is where that effect on through infrastructure might happen. And in forest cover, protected areas do change forest cover. There is avoided deforestation and extra regrowth that's happening as a result of protected areas, but we don't see that leading to any change in poverty. Right? And when you look at that last outcome, does that mean that ecosystem services aren't relevant, or changing land use doesn't benefit the poor? It's hard to know, because all we did was measure the effect of protection on forest cover and then its impacts on poverty. But when you break down the causal pathways, there's ecosystem services that might help the poor, ecosystem services like predation from wildlife that might hurt the poor, and then there's the consumptive activities that the poor are denied as a result of protection, or that may be encouraged, like medicinal plants or other consumptive activities. And the problem is that it's hard to get observations of these. So we can't disentangle the fact that the salutary and detrimental effects are small or zero, right? So there really is no effects of denying people access to resources or giving them extra ecosystem services, or both types of effects are opposite sign and approximately equal, thus canceling out, subject to sampling error and variability. And again, these studies, I don't have a slide on it, are really hard, because one, you got to deal with all these confounding factors. Two, you actually have to measure the mechanisms themselves, which is hard to do. And three, you need these elaborate theories that postulate how actually would this protection work in a particular context. How would it affect human welfare? How would it affect species abundance? And we're often lacking all three of those. We don't have good selection stories, so we can't control for the confounders. We don't have measures of the mechanisms themselves, and we don't have these elaborate theories. All right, so the second observation I want to make is about a big one that people are worried about everywhere, but particularly in developing countries, is the trade-offs between poverty alleviation and environmental goals. All right, since there's so few studies on the poverty side, you can imagine that we don't know a lot, but what we do know, I'd say, is some good news and some bad news. So the good news is people are finding that protected areas reduce deforestation, they encourage regrowth, they reduce degradation, they reduce fire. Right, so some of the outcomes that people have looked at. And it doesn't exacerbate poverty in most places people have looked, and in some places it's actually reduced poverty. It's alleviated poverty. So that sounds like a win-win situation. Right? And indeed, there are areas where if you start trying to understand the moderators, right, what affects where we see a lot of trying to avoid deforestation. That's on this graph, this axis right here, environmental suitability, and what alleviates poverty. That's what we see on the socioeconomic suitability, 10 being better on both axes. We can find regions where we get a lot of avoided deforestation or environmental benefits and a lot of socioeconomic benefits. Right? But we've got other areas where we're not seeing, you're seeing one or the other. Right? So by understanding heterogeneity, you can understand what these trade-offs might be in any particular country. Most analyses find a lot of heterogeneity. The effects of protection are not homogeneous across the landscape. They vary a lot by landscape characteristics, where you've sited it, and the characteristics of the people that live there. And this heterogeneity seems to vary by country. I don't see a consistent story yet coming out except for a few things like slope. But with that information, you could take a look at some of these possible trade-offs. And by and large, people are finding trade-offs. So there are overlaps, but by and large, people, when they look at how the impacts, so this is the impacts in the green of protection on avoided deforestation. The higher up it is, the greater the amount of avoided deforestation and poverty alleviation. So the higher it is, the more poverty reduction we're getting. So going up is good for both of these. And down here, this is just one variable, but you can look at lots of other ones, moderators. This is slope. So as you're going this way, you're getting steeper. And so what do you see in avoided deforestation? Avoided deforestation starts rising as things get steeper and then goes low. So in the really steep slopes, you're not getting much avoided deforestation. Again, it wasn't very threatened in the first place with economic activity. Why this bend here? We can talk about that. It seems largely because there's a lot of non-compliance. When the stuff is really agriculturally valued, even though it's protected, it's still being cut down. So you're not getting as big of a reduction. And here's poverty reduction. What you can see is there's some overlap where you're getting high avoided deforestation and high poverty alleviation. But the big area where you're getting poverty alleviation is on the steepest slopes. That's where you're getting the lowest avoided deforestation. So this is tricky with the win-win. So there are points where I'm getting both poverty alleviation and avoided deforestation. But if I want to have more of one, I'm often going to have to give up more of the other. All right, so there's win-win, and I can find places where I can get both, but there's still these trade-offs are there. As I try to get more poverty alleviation, I'm going to get less environmental outcomes and vice versa. And that's been found in the, you know, again, it's a small number of countries where people have looked. Generally, that's what people have found. Right? So there's only a few of studies have examined both avoided deforestation and poverty, but the few have found this sort of trade-off. But they are finding overlaps where you can get both. Right? So if there is, there are, at least for the countries where it's been done, some guidance that one can give if you're worried about poverty and environmental outcomes. Again, we're only measuring really just a few so far, deforestation and regrowth and maybe degradation, and if you're lucky, it suggests that you can find places where there's overlap, but if you're trying to maximize one, you may not be getting much of the other in a particular country. All right, but the thing I want to caution you about is everybody wants to know what moderates impact. So I was talking with Bhaskar today, and they've got a project trying to figure out what makes impacts bigger in some locations than in others. And then you have to be really careful about my studies and anybody else who's looking at heterogeneity. And we say things vary by slope, or they vary by the characteristic of the people, or distance to road. Is this problem that if you look at enough moderators, you'll find these correlations. These are a lot less credible than just the average impacts. So I'm on a paper now where we don't really find any average impacts. But then the grad student writing it said, but when I look at distance from road or forest edge, distance from forest edge, I find an impact that people are farther from the forest edge, they get a better impact. And then he created the story that explains why that is. And you gotta be really careful that when people start looking for heterogeneity, you're gonna find it even in randomized controlled trials that are not causally related. And this is just a quote from the British Medical Journal that argued that even in randomized controlled trials, people are really dissuaded from looking for subgroup analysis, males versus females, different races, old versus young, people with backaches, people without backaches, because you look at enough subgroups, you will find differences even in randomized controlled trial data. And for the few times that people have gone back to actually randomize within the subgroup, so they can actually measure male versus female, backache versus no backache, whatever, old versus young, they often don't find any differences in their impacts. And so it's just something, a word of caution. I think we need to understand heterogeneity more and what moderates impacts of protected areas. But as we do that, it's getting less and less credible, and it's really important to specify what variables you're gonna look at before you start looking at the data. And this is something that randomized control trials are now forced to do. If they're gonna do subgroup analysis, they have to keep it small, and they have to put it in their protocol before they ever do the experiment. And we don't do experiments, so we've basically on an honor system here, where if these are the variables you're looking at, you didn't just pick them because they gave you statistical significance. You chose them in advance based on good theory or practical reasons, field expertise, and that's what you found out. All right, so almost done. I want to make one more point, and I want one more survey here. So what type of de jure? So, because I know protected areas might be classified one way, but in practice they're managed differently on the field. But given what they're labeled as, which ones are more ecologically impactful? And impactful is the difference between what we see and what the counterfactual would be. And I broke it up into federal, national, strictly protected areas, and multi-use, and then state or local level, lower administration than national protected areas. So strict versus less strict or multi-use, and we can define those in different ways, just take the definitions I have, and state versus federal. Sort of interesting that strict federal, yes, but not strict state level. I don't know how many people, so you should, when you answer this, don't look at what other people are doing. I don't know if people, if some of you out there just like symmetry and are answering things that are low just to get the bars to be more equal. All right, so once again, it's all over the place, right? So, and that's, again, it's not because you haven't read the literature, it's because we know very little about that, and there's lots of reasons to believe any of these could be more impactful. Now, the one that's biggest are strictly protected federal or national protected areas. Well, let me ask you this. So if you've got multi-use and strict, let's just say it's at the national level, and here's an area that's really economically profitable to exploit, and there's a lot of potential users, developers, timber industry, ag industry, that are all interested in it, and the government wants to protect it. Right, so there's likely, if they don't protect it, there are people interested in cutting this thing down. What kind of protected area are they likely put there? Multi-use or strict? Shout out, you Brits are so reserved. Pretend we're at a Trump rally, you're just shouting stuff out. Build the wall, make America great again. Don't know why strictly protected areas, would it be strictly protected areas or be the multi-use that are more likely to get put?
Multi-use.
Right? Just because the political pressure is so strong. Right? So where do you put strictly protected areas where nobody's fighting about it that hard, or where politically powerless folks are not going to be able to push back on it? And so this is sort of the weird thing. So the place with the fewer rules could actually have larger impacts because it's placed in places that are more threatened. Again, it's because if we just randomly assign strictly protected and multi-use, strictly protected, if they're actually enforced, will probably have bigger impacts. But they're not randomly assigned, and the characteristics are associated with where we put strictly protected versus multi-use. So if that's the comparison, the impact difference of those two, we may actually get more impact with multi-use than with strictly protected. And again, we don't have enough data to say the strict protection is not strictly better protection, but we have some country data. So Brazil is an example where that seems to be the case. And we've got a paper in Environmental Resource Letters where Bolivia, that seems to be the case. But in Indonesia and Costa Rica and Thailand, it seems like strictly protected areas do have bigger impacts. And again, it's impacts compared to What? Compared to putting a multi-use on the same site or compared to nothing at all? I mean, the relevant question for a lot of managers is, here's a site, should I do strict or multi-use? What's going to be the different differences and impacts? Because strict protection is a much bigger fight typically in the political realm, and I want to know if it's how much of an impact it's going to actually have in a particular area. All right, so again, it's one of those things we don't really know enough, but there's enough to think about. If you're thinking about selection and some of the data that's coming in that suggests that even though it sounds like strict protection is the way to go, it may not be the most impactful because you're never going to get strict protection on the kind of land that's most threatened in a lot of countries. All right, so the last slide is what I think the frontier is, and you can add things or criticize this. So we looked a lot at deforestation, a little bit on degradation, a bit on regrowth, some on fire, but really we need to be moving toward ecosystem services, ecological function would be better, and then subsequently those changes impact on human welfare. So if you increase hydrological services or pollination services, what's the impact on human welfare? And to do that sort of stuff is going to be hard because we often lack measures of the ecosystem services, we lack baselines on them, and we need to meld impact evaluation ecosystem service modeling. And I'm not going to be able to measure with observable data the impact on hydrological services. I can measure the effects on landscape change, and then a hydrologist might have a model that does scenarios. If landscape changes this way, what's the impact on hydrological services? Right now, you've got the impact evaluation person looking at changes in landscape, and nobody really cares about changes in landscape. It's what does that actually end up doing to ecosystem services and biodiversity? And then you got modelers on this side who just say, imagine scenario one, imagine scenario three, the landscape looks like that, it looks like this. What's the effect on pollination? What's the effect on hydrological services? What I want to know is, here's what we did, here's how it changed the landscape, and then it goes through that model, here's how it changed ecosystem services. We need to bring those two literatures together. Right, so we've got people doing the modeling over here, we've got people doing how does protected area affect land use, and depending on the observable characteristics, put that in the scenario analysis and we might be able to actually elaborate and elucidate these causal pathways and the effect on ecosystem structure, on the services, and then on poverty or whatever human welfare indicator you want to use at the end. In an article last year, we tried to do that for something really simple, carbon, where we tried to look at the impacts of protected areas on carbon in four different countries and then compare it to what's going on with poverty and that sort of thing. But carbon is really easy because it doesn't require that much modeling. You convert the biomass measures to some measures of carbon, pretty straightforward. But all the other services are going to be a lot harder to do. Second one are protected areas and heterogeneous treatments, right? Protected areas aren't homogenous. I talked about strict versus multi-use, but there's a lot more variation out there, and we have very little evidence on variations in rules, variations in enforcement, variation in participation, or sharing of benefits with local communities. We have lots of arguments back and forth about communities should be participating. No, communities should not. We should have local guards. No, we should have external guards. We should have armed guards. No, we shouldn't have armed guards. And very little evidence on impacts of these different ways that we can vary the inputs into protected areas. And some people have heard me saying, we should be doing more experimental variation. We have control through our partnerships where we can vary the level of participation in communities across protected areas. Right, in principle, I know this is hard to do in practice, but they're doing it in other fields. They're varying the composition of community resource boards to bring in more women, for example, or more racial or ethnic diversity and seeing what impacts those have. We have all these performance scorecards that have all these inputs for protected areas, the Met and other tools, where we say, if you do more of this, somehow we're moving toward more impacts. It'd be good to start fleshing some of that out because none of that is based on any empirical evidence. It's based on narratives, observations, and theory. And the idea would be to get best practice processes that we can send down to the field that they could actually do. Other frontier is conservation planning. A huge literature on that is trying to predict where we should put things. Right? How do we bring in impact evaluation? Because that's what we care about. I don't want to put protected areas where there's the most carbon or where there's the most hydrological potential or where there's the most species, right? That sounds strange and a delight. I don't want to put it where there are most species. I want to put it where I'm going to avoid the most species loss. I want to put it where I get the most additional hydrological services. I want to put it where I get the most pollination services, avoided carbon loss. Right? So that requires knowing how impacts vary, what causes them to vary, and then putting them into these conservation planning models where we try to maximize not coverage, but impacts. And if you want to put it into cost-benefit analysis, which is even farther down, we actually put dollar values on these things, like some people are doing with these ecosystem modelings, well, then you're maximizing economic value through this. But it's about impacts, not about coverage. And we've really done nothing with that so far. And the last one I don't want to talk about, but I'll mention it for grad students who are doing spatial work, is in protected areas, there's all sorts of ways in which people are defining the units. The whole protected area, pixels that they randomly pick, grids, you know, 1 kilometer square grids, 5 square kilometers, administrative units, districts, counties, municipalities. These got to matter for statistical inference, and there's really no work that's been done to help elucidate how the spatial attributes of the context matter for drawing inferences about impacts. And so with that, let's leave it open to conversation, discussion, critiques, and additions. Thank you very much. That's a little bit longer than I wanted to. All right.
Let's just go for a few more minutes. I know we're over 6, but it's a few more minutes. A few questions.
Thank you. Isn't what we want to do actually, it's not just about impacts, it's about net benefits.
So what's the difference?
Because we need to think about the costs of achieving the impact. And
right.
And actually it's more complicated than you're making it.
So that's exactly
right. But you're making
right.
it really complicated.
I know.
And so it's going to be really, really complicated.
That's right. So I mean it's about maximizing impact, maximizing cost effectiveness, and then maximizing net benefits. That's even farther down the chain. So I'm trying to be ambitious, but not that ambitious. Because I don't want to demoralize everyone.
So, having been thoroughly demoralized, yesterday you complained about not being attacked enough. So
yeah,
in that spirit. This is really complicated, and it's going to take a very, very long time to even think about how we should be doing it, although obviously you've got a long way towards that. Then we have to actually get the data, and then we have to analyze it again, and then there's a long time frame on this, right, to get anything useful out of it.
Right.
So is it the best way for us to be spending our time and our intellectual effort, or is there something else we could be doing which might give us more bang for our brain?
That's a really good question. I mean, let some of the audience. I would say, a lot of it comes down to how expensive is it to manage these protected areas. If it's not very expensive, it's not sucking away a lot of our resources, then doesn't matter. A little bit of evidence that's coming out suggests modest impacts. Doesn't seem to be seriously immiserating people. So continue status quo, and let's figure out some of these other interventions, what impacts they're having. But my sense, I look at the Global Environment Facility, a big part of their portfolio goes into protected areas. I don't know if anybody's figured out what portion of the conservation budget goes in, or if you've looked at it, Andrew, or anyone else. It really depends on a function. If a lot of resources are going into that, we should know whether or not it's working the way we intended and what the cost effectiveness is. But it's an important question because you're right, we have all these interventions out there. How are we going to get evidence? We really need to pick and choose the interventions and where we work so we can get the most learning from them. Good question.
Hi, thanks for the interesting talk, Paul. There are some places in the world where new networks of protected areas are being currently designed or have just been put in place. Mm-hmm. I wondered if you are involved in any projects that are doing baseline monitoring on those places, places like China and, for instance, the marine protected areas around the UK are relatively newly designed.
No, so I'm not involved in any newly designed. Other conservation interventions, yes, but not protected areas. One of the most intriguing ones is this one in Indonesia that some people involved in, where they went in before some of the protected areas, where they collected baseline in where it was going to impact in comparable sites to look at both social and environmental indicators. Again, we don't have to do this everywhere. We were talking about this earlier. We don't need to do it for every protected areas out there. But for some, it would be useful to gain some insights in terms of whether our models of how the world works are reasonably accurate.
Final question.
Thanks, Paul. Good to see you again. I've got two questions for you. Well, one is more of challenging your concept, the thought concept there. And the other one is whether you've got, we've talked a lot about protected areas as a treatment. I'm wondering whether you're aware of any other studies that are looking at conservation treatment, other conservation treatments in other types of landscapes, agro environmental systems where we also are trying to conserve biodiversity. And the other one, which is about challenging your third concept there, is so there's other schools of thought. For example, Hugh Possingham pushes the agenda we should maximize our conservation dollars where we're going to get most species conserved.
And right, but he doesn't model it that way. He does most species covered, right? So I agree that we want to get most, I think it depends on what the definition of conserved is. Right? For me, it's compared to the counterfactual, what would happen in that landscape had we not intervened. With a lot of conservation planning, it has an implicit assumption, if I don't cover it, it will be gone. So I want to cover with protection or something.
The effort, my understanding is that the effort should go to where you're going to gain most species as opposed to saying, let's conserve here because we might lose this species. It's let's conserve here because we might get a bigger chunk of the species as opposed to that is already gone, even if we're going to invest a lot more dollars invested in that place, A, as opposed to B, where you're going to get more, even if they're less threatened.
Yeah, I mean, that could be, that's a source of debate. What should be the objective in here? So you can bring in the dollars part. I don't have any problem with saying, well, how much are we getting as a return for every dollar we spend? We should try to improve that. But the question is, do I just get as much species as I possibly can protected, even if the counterfactual is most of them would have been fine anyway, even without that protection? Or is the best to get the species covered that would have been most likely to be degraded or damaged in the absence of this protection? And again, you can argue a variety of ways, particularly if you're thinking about a very long term. So some people argue, well, they're not threatened now, but in 50, 100 years, they are going to be threatened, and we're locking them up now. That's a reasonable argument, but you just need to make that argument. Don't say you're having an impact now, but argue why you're doing it. Yeah, Reese.
Just following on from that, on your other argument that it's easiest to establish protected areas where nobody really wants to do any threatening activities, surely that is a case for going for maximum coverage, even though you may not be doing anything now.
Only if you believe that the stuff would eventually go, right? But like Costa Rica, you look at stuff that was protected in the early 70s compared to stuff that wasn't protected but looks similar, most of it's intact even if it wasn't protected. Now, but that's a gamble, and I understand that we might not want to take that gamble. I'm looking with hindsight, the benefit of hindsight, but we might say, I really strongly believe this landscape is going to go eventually. I don't know if it's 10 years, 20 years, 30 years going to go. Politically and financially cheap to lock it up, let's do that. But it is sucking away resources from things we could be doing right now. And all I would ask is that the debate's really clear about why we're doing what we're doing. If it's for that reason, that's fine. But we just need to put that out there rather than saying, I'm somehow having an impact today with the resources, that we're not putting money into incentivizing farmers right now to change their practices. We're going to use it to get the stuff that's not very threatened and lock it up for later. And I mean, again, it comes down to having some sense of the impact, at least of the incentive payment, so you know what you're giving up. It's hard to know what's going to happen in 100 years, but at least you would like to know what you're giving up to gain that protection many years in the future.
I'm sorry to interrupt this lively and important debate, which is
clearly really interesting. Wearing two hats today, wearing a crash hat for the humanitarians lecture, and we're wearing a CCI hat for the CCI Lecture Theatre lecture series. Wearing that CCI hat, I'd like Nigel Leader-Williams to say a couple of words. Nigel.
Thank you very much, Bill. We've had a series of 15 seminars during the course of the past two terms. They've been wonderfully attended as always, highly varied in content and subject matter covered. And getting a series like that advertised and out and organized the level it is requires somebody very dedicated to take it on. Unfortunately, she's not here to embarrass tonight with a transfer of chocolates, but there will be a transfer of her favorite box of chocolates tomorrow to thank her very much indeed for the year's seminars that we've enjoyed, that she's organized so well.
So when you see her, thank her in person, because she's been doing a great job. So today's been brilliant, and if you've got any more... Sorry? Who is it? Lisa Harris. Sorry, didn't we say?
She doesn't get named, just chocolate.
Yeah, Lisa Harris. Yeah, okay, yeah.
Did she get paid?
That's a good job, yeah. The fourth question, yes, she does. She doesn't just get paid in chocolates. So that talk was brilliant. It was important, tackling really important issues. If you want to hear more, there's a workshop on Friday. Please book for that. The Last of the Humanities Chair events. So we're delighted by all the things that are happening. Remember to come to that workshop. Remember to come to the John Bennington lecture on the 11th of April. And then finally, I'd like to thank Paul for what I think we all agree was a lively and important and really interesting lecture. Thanks so much, Paul.